And moreover, I spoke about external internal, right? Carotids. I didn't speak about maxillary artery. Not yet, huh? No, right? Right. Coming to the thyroid gland, where is your thyroid gland located? Lock. Where is your thyroid gland located? Huh? Yeah, below the larynx, in front of trachea. Below the larynx, this is your larynx, this is your trachea. Exactly here your thyroid gland is located. Now, how do you know it? Because how do you know is, for example, what you do is you completely retract this tissue. After retracting this tissue, what you do is you swallow like this. Now, when you swallow, the entire part moves and the only one part remains intact. So that is your thyroid gland. In front of mirror, you do not know. Anyways, so thyroid gland is located below the larynx in front of trachea, right? So normally thyroid gland is what shape? This you know, right? Butterfly shape. So thyroid gland has cells, many cells like this. So all these cells are called as thyroid. Very good, follicles, thyroid follicles. For example, in this way, like flower shape. In this way, you have thyroid follicles. Many thyroid follicles like this, right? So this one is called as your thyroid follicle, and this one is called as the other thyroid follicle, right? Now, surrounding this thyroid follicle, see, thyroid follicle has this center part, this with this blue thing which I'm drawing here. This is called as the lumen, and surrounding this, you have what? Follicular cells. Okay, now. This is a thyroid follicle. So side near to it, you have another cells. What are these cells called? No. These are called parafollicular cells. Parathyroid is here. Parathyroid glands are here on the back. On the back, you have these parathyroid glands. Clear? So this is a thyroid follicle. And these are the follicular cells. These blue cells surrounding these are side to it. Side, so you call it as para. Parafollicular cells, right? Now, why is this so important? Why is this so important? Is this thyroid follicles, they release thyroxine. That is your T3, T4, right? These parafollicular cells, they release calcitonin. Calcitonin is calcium lowering hormone. Now, what do I mean? I already talked about vitamin D, right? So, what I discussed there, calcitonin, when it is released, what does calcitonin do? For example, this is your bone, right? Now, there is a lot of calcium in the blood. What does calcitonin do is, it will take all the calcium from the blood to the bone and it will deposit on the bone. So, in the blood, calcium levels are becoming low. So, you call it as calcium lowering hormone. But anyways, that is not our discussion. Our discussion is thyroxine, how is it released from how it is synthesized, first of all, in these follicular cells and how it is released. Clear? You are clear with this?
Yes.
Very good. Now, for example, this is your thyroid gland. Right. Now, in this thyroid gland, you have two lobes and the center of this part is called isthmus. Okay? Now, you have an artery that is supplying to the thyroid gland from the top. You have an artery that is supplying to the thyroid gland from the bottom. Now, the artery that is supplying from the top, you have to call it as superior thyroid artery. From the bottom is called as inferior thyroid artery. I already spoke that superior thyroid artery is a branch of... So, you are not revising it? Very good. It is a branch of external carotid artery. The first branch of external carotid artery. Now you got to know, right? Superior thyroid artery is the first branch of external carotid artery. Inferior thyroid artery, from where does it come? Let me write it. Inferior thyroid artery is a branch of subclavian artery. Subclavian artery. And superior thyroid artery is a branch of external carotid artery. Very important. You have to remember it. Okay? Don't think that superior and inferior are coming from the same branches. No. But anyways, so now what I'll be doing is, I'll draw an artery either it might be a superior or inferior, that doesn't matter. I'll draw an artery, and as you know, synthesis of thyroid hormone is happening within the follicles, right? So see here, I'll draw one follicular cell, okay? One follicular cell. So this is lumen, these are your follicular cells, these are your follicular cells, and this is lumen. For example, if my thyroid hormone, for example, if my thyroid hormone is synthesized here, this thyroid hormone is secreted into the lumen, right? So now what I'll draw on the background is that I'll draw one artery, right? One artery, and I'll draw one follicle, and I'll draw the lumen, and I'll explain you the synthesis of thyroid hormone. Now you understood it clearly? Done? Right. Now look here. One artery. So this might be your superior thyroid artery, or this might be your inferior thyroid artery, whatever it is. Clear? Right? Now below that you have what? What you have? This is your thyroid follicle. This one is your thyroid follicle. And this is the lumen. Clear? See, simple thing. What I've drawn is, I've drawn one artery here, right? I drew one artery, and after that I have, see, this is the follicular cell and the lumen is here. Clear? Now, how does the synthesis of thyroid hormone generally happen? Get inside firstly. How does the synthesis of thyroid hormone generally happen? The synthesis of thyroid hormone, look here. Now, for the synthesis of thyroid hormone, what do we need? What anion we need? Yeah, very good. It is iodine. We need iodine, right? Because in the some of the places, there will be iodine deficiency. So when there is iodine deficiency, thyroid hormone is not produced. So when thyroid hormone is not produced, the babies, they are born with the deficiency of thyroid hormone. So this condition is called cretinism. But anyways, I'll discuss it in the end. But for now, you are sure that we need thyroid iodine for the synthesis of thyroid hormone. Clear? Now look here. Generally, when you eat the food, right, the iodized salt, whatever you take, that form of iodine is this one. I minus. I minus stands for iodine or iodide? Iodide. So through diet, the iodine which you are getting is in the form of iodide, right? Iodide. Now, this iodide, you have to send it into the cell first, right? So this iodide has to go into the cell in this way. But this is a polar or non-polar? Polar compound. It cannot cross the membrane. So but how did it cross then? It shouldn't cross. So there has to be some transporter protein, right? So that it transports. Now what is a transporter protein? Look here. Here on the membrane you have a transporter protein here. This is called as, very important, remember, iodide trapper. This is called iodide trapper. Okay? This transporter protein is called iodide trapper. Now with the help of this iodide trapper, iodide enters into your lumen. It enters into your follicular cell, right? Now as soon as it enters into your follicular cell, all the way this iodide goes towards, what is this? It goes towards the lumen. So this is your iodide going towards the lumen, right? This is iodide going towards your lumen. Now look what happens. Iodide, once it enters into your lumen here, iodide gets converted to iodine, right? Iodide, once it enters into the lumen, it gets converted to iodine. It means there is a reduction or oxidation. There is oxidation of iodide, right? Oxidation of iodide. So the first step which we came to know is there is oxidation of I minus iodide to iodine. You are clear so far, right? Now leave this story here. Leave this story here. Now in the meanwhile, what happens is within your within your follicular cell, every cell has a nucleus. Agree? Now what does nucleus do? It synthesizes different proteins, right? For example, this is your nucleus here, and this nucleus is synthesizing a special type of protein. So this is the protein which is synthesized by this nucleus. So what is the name of this protein? The name of this protein is, tell me, what are these blue things which I'm drawing here? No. See, protein is made up of what? Amino acids. So out of all amino acids, I'm just drawing few amino acids here. Clear? These are nothing but amino acids. Now listen. So nucleus has synthesized a protein. This protein is called as thyroglobulin. Okay, the name of this protein is thyroglobulin, right? Now this thyroglobulin, all the way it is sent into the lumen. Clear? This thyroglobulin, all the way it is sent into the lumen. So this is your thyroglobulin which is sent into the lumen, and thyroglobulin has, what are these dots here, blue dots which I am drawing? These are the what amino acids? I mean, there are many amino acids of course, but for our topic, the amino acid which I am taking is tyrosine. Okay, so each one is a tyrosine amino acid. Clear so far, right? Now in this total thing, so far what we have discussed, first thing what we have discussed is conversion of iodide to iodine, that is called oxidation. The second thing is synthesis of thyroglobulin, right? Synthesis of thyroglobulin. Now after the synthesis of thyroglobulin has done, now look what happens. This iodide, whatever is there, iodine, it attaches to these tyrosine amino acids. So the process of attachment of iodine to tyrosine amino acids is called organification. Okay, so what exactly happens is iodine molecule gets attached to this tyrosine amino acids. So this process is called as, third process is organification of what? Organification of iodine. Clear? What are the thyroid hormones we have? T3, T4. You are sure about this? Done. Now look here. See, sometimes it might happen like this, that how the organification process occurs is, one iodide molecule attaches here, right? Sometimes iodine molecules attach here. Sometimes one iodine, sometimes two iodine, sometimes two, sometimes one iodine, sometimes two iodine molecules. So in this way they are organified. This is called as organification. Clear? Now one iodine, one tyrosine, I have to call it as monoiodotyrosine. Clear? Monoiodotyrosine. Two iodines, one tyrosine, diiodotyrosine. Monoiodotyrosine, diiodotyrosine, diiodotyrosine, the same thing as follows. Any doubt you have so far? So this is called MIT, monoiodotyrosine. This is called DIT, diiodotyrosine. Again, monoiodotyrosine, diiodotyrosine, the same thing. Clear? So far you have learned three steps: oxidation, synthesis of thyroglobulin, and organification of iodine. Clear? Now the fourth one is, look here. coupling reaction. Fourth one is coupling reaction. Now, what does coupling reaction mean? What does coupling reaction mean is, look here. This monoiodotyrosine, diiodotyrosine, they both of them join together. Both of them join together. When they both of them join together, the resultant is triiodotyrosine. That is T3. Clear? Now, sometimes it might happen like this. See, monoiodo, diiodo, together they form T3 again. Clear? But look here. Look here. Diiodotyrosine, together T4. And this is T2. Clear? You are clear so far? So, in this reaction is called as coupling reaction. Clear? Now, so far we have discussed four things. Oxidation, synthesis, organification and coupling. Now, all these, does they happen like that? No, there should be some enzyme, right? Right? There should be some enzyme. So, normally, see, as I told, this is the thyroid gland. Sorry, this is the thyroid follicle. This is the lumen. And these are your follicular cells. And here you have artery, superior or inferior thyroid artery, whatever it is. Right? Now, this part of the lumen, this part of the follicular cell is called as basal cell, basal membrane. Basal membrane. And this part which is facing towards the lumen is called as luminal membrane. So, what should be this called? Very good. On the luminal membrane, you have a lot of enzymes. Right? So, lot of what enzymes? Lot of enzymes that perform these four reactions. For example, see, here you have an enzyme like this. Here you have an enzyme. All these are similar enzymes, but many in number. Clear? They are located on the luminal side. Now, this enzyme is called as thyroid peroxidase. This enzyme is called as thyroid peroxidase. So, you are clear so far? Thyroid peroxidase is an enzyme that performs four functions. One is it converts iodide to iodine, oxidation reaction. Second thing is it also simultaneously it synthesizes thyroglobin. Simultaneously it performs oxidation, it means attachment of iodine to this thyroglobin, but where? To the tyrosine amino acids. Okay. Fourth function is it couples two different two tyrosine amino acids. Clear? So in this way, T3, T4, all these are produced. Now you understood this picture. Clear? Now look here, I'll make a simplified picture of this. So if you have understood this, now look here. So this is your thyroglobin. Now in this thyroglobin, you have what? You have T3, you have T4, you have T2, you have T3, again you have T4, like this. Clear? Now, all of this, they enter back into the cell. All of this, they enter back into the cell like this. 3, 2, 2, 3, 4. Clear? Clear? Now, how do they enter back? Through a process called? Endocytosis. After some time, what will happen? They fuse together and they fuse as a separate, they form a separate vesicle. Now, in this way, there are millions of vesicles in this. There must be millions of vesicles in this follicular cell. Yes or no? Agree? Now, look here. Now, what is our next step? The next step is we have to separate T3, T2, T4 into each part. Yes or no? We have to separate, we have to break down this chain so that we get a pure T4, we get a pure T3 and all. Clear? Now what happens is, you know, within the cell we have lysosomes, right? These lysosomes, they come here and attach. So these are the lysosomes. They come here, they attach all the way, and lysosomes have what enzymes? hydrolytic enzymes. Now these hydrolytic enzymes are released into this vesicle. Now the moment hydrolytic enzymes are released into this vesicle, what will be the resultant breakdown of this? Yes or no? There is breakdown of this. So when there is breakdown of this, finally into the blood we have T3 and T4. Clear? We have T3 and T4. So this is how thyroid hormone is synthesized. You are clear with this?
What happens with T2?
T2, it is recycled again. Okay? T2 is recycled again. You are clear with this? Just look at it. You are done? Now, why I told this is, see, normally on this follicular cell, you have receptors like this. These receptors are called as TSH receptors. Now, through our previous endocrinology lecture, what we have discussed? We have discussed that this is your anterior pituitary. For example, this is your thyroid gland. Normally, thyroid gland releases T3, T4. Out of T3, T4, which is highly active is T3. Okay? At one or the other time, T4 will be converted to T3 and T3 is an active form. T4 is an inactive form. Okay? Now, this T3, T4 are released. Same thing. Positive negative feedback mechanism. If T3, T4 are more, then it will inhibit or activate. Inhibit the secretion of what? TSH. Yes? For example, if T3, T4 are very less, so it will activate the anterior pituitary, so the TSH release will be more, and this increased TSH will activate the thyroid gland. When it will activate the thyroid gland, this process is increased. So more T3, T4 is produced. Exactly where does this TSH bind? TSH binds here, onto the follicular cells. So this is the place where TSH binds. Clear? Now, for example, if TSH in my body is more, what will happen? The first thing, if TSH in my body, if it is more, the first thing what is going to happen is synthesis of T3, T4, not increased synthesis of T3, T4, right? For example, I am hypothyroid. For example, I am not hypothyroid, but for example, I am hypothyroid. Right? If I am hypothyroid, then my thyroid gland has to release more T3, T4, right? Because thyroid hormones act almost on all the tissues, all the cells on your body. It acts on all the cells in your body. It has a role in gluconeogenesis, it has a role in regulating your blood pressure, everything, even the neurons also. Clear? If I have low production of T3, T4, so what should I do? I have to increase its production, right? So what should I do? What should I do is I have to increase the release of TSH. Now when I increase the release of TSH, thyroid gland is overstimulated or understimulated? Overstimulated. Then thyroid gland will release more T3, T4. Now in supportive to that, adding upon that, to support it, what can I do? To release more T3, T4, not only just activation, I should also increase the number of cells. When I increase the number of cells, the production of T3, T4 will be much more. And third thing what I can do, I can increase the size of the cell. When I increase the size of the cell, heavy amount will be released, which is even good for me, right? So when TSH is acting on the cell, three things happen. The first thing is, you know the synthesis. Second thing is, increase in size of the cell, which you called as hypertrophy. Hypertrophy is increase in size of the cell. Third thing, there will be increase in number of cells, which you called as hyperplasia. Hyperplasia is increase in number of cells. Clear? So in this way, overall what I am doing? I am increasing my production of T3 and T4. Clear? Overall what I am doing? I am increasing the production of T3 and T4. So this is the basic thing that happens whenever a molecule of TSH falls on this receptor. Clear so far? Right? Now look here. For example, if patient is hyperthyroid, he's releasing more and more and more T3, T4. Later I'll discuss the advantages and disadvantages of hypo and hyperthyroid, the differences between both of them. But for now, hypothyroid is problematic. At the same time, hyperthyroidism is also a problematic condition. Okay. Now, if a person is releasing more T3, T4, so what should I do? I have to reduce it or still increase it? I have to reduce it. For example, if I give such a drug which blocks this iodide trapper, can iodine come inside?
No.
Can this thing happen?
No.
Can T3, T4 be released?
No.
So the drug which I can use here is perchlorates. Perchlorates, or I can also use thiocyanates. Thiocyanates or perchlorates. What they do is, they come all the way and they block this iodide trapper. Clear? Are you clear or confused? You're clear. So I can use this drug in case of hyperthyroid patient. Very important, remember it. The treatment for hyperthyroidism is perchlorates or thiocyanates. Okay? As far as your croak and IFOM is concerned. You're clear so far? Right. But there is one problem. Look here. I stopped the uptake of iodide, but what I'm doing indirectly is, when I've stopped the uptake of iodide, synthesis of T3 and T4 has lowered, right? So when T3, T4 is low, then there will be positive feedback mechanism or negative feedback. So there will be increase TSH. Now increased TSH will act here, because this receptor is not blocked, so it can act here. Now when it will act here, what will happen? This TSH will make the cell to increase the production of T3, T4. But you don't have the source, you don't have the iodide. So how T3, T4 will be produced? It cannot be produced, right? But two other things can happen. What are these two other things? Size can increase and number can increase. Clear? So overall, if you look at a bird wave, T3, T4 is reduced, but thyroid gland size, there is hypertrophy of the thyroid gland. At the same time, there is number of follicular cells are increased. It means hyperplasia. So how will my thyroid gland look? Swollen thyroid gland. This is called? Very good, goiter. Now, you might think, you see a patient who is having increased thyroid gland, you might think, oh my god, his thyroid gland is increased, he might be releasing a lot of T3, T4. No, it's wrong. Goiter is, what does goiter mean is that, goiter is just increase in the size of the gland. Goiter explains just the structural change, not the functional change. You are clear with that? Clear? So, from today, whenever you see thyroid gland size, increased thyroid gland, unless and until you take the blood reports, you should not diagnose him telling that he is hyperthyroid. No. Clear? You understood this? You understood the mechanism of the drug? In pharmacology, mechanism is important, action of the drug, and the result. This is important. Clear? So, perchlorates, thiocyanates, the mechanism of action is, they block iodide trapper. The first thing. Second thing. Side effect is goiter. Side effect is goiter. Third thing, what is the result? Hypothyroidism. So I can use this drug in the patient who is having hyperthyroidism. Clear? Right. Next thing is, instead of using these drugs, I can also use another drug. Okay. Look at this. For example, if I use such a drug which blocks thyroid peroxidase, the story is the same. The single difference is iodine will come till here happily, but after that it cannot be oxidized, right? Is it making sense? Clear? So if you are blocking thyroid peroxidase, then the story is the same. The same things you see, right? Now what you have to know, what are the drugs that are blocking the thyroid peroxidase? One is propylthiouracil. Propylthiouracil. And the second one is carbimazole. Propylthiouracil and carbimazole are two drugs which block thyroid peroxidase. So, I can also use this propylthiouracil and carbimazole for hyperthyroidism, right? When any patient who is hyperthyroid, go and check his thyroid tablets. Most commonly, we use propylthiouracil. Nothing else we use. I don't know why. But we generally use propylthiouracil for hyperthyroidism. Clear? You are clear with this? Right? Right. Now look here. Differences between hyperthyroidism and hypothyroidism. Now what are the differences between hyper and hypothyroidism? Now, everyone. Hyperthyroidism. What is happening in hyperthyroidism? Increased T3, T4 or low? Increased T3, T4 production. More T3, T4 acts on all the cells in your body. Right? By the way, what is the use of thyroid hormone? Very good. First thing is growth, physical growth, right? Physical growth. Why I am telling physical? Because you also have mental growth. Mental growth and basal metabolic rate. So these are the most important three functions of your thyroid hormone. Now look, patient is having hyperthyroidism. For example, if I am having hyperthyroidism, my thyroid levels are more. Now when my thyroid levels are more, I will have more basal metabolic rate. It means every cell in my body is hyper functioning. It means every cell in my body is releasing lots and lots of ATP, lots and lots of energy, lots and lots of heat, right? Lots and lots of heat. So hyperthyroid patient will be hot all the time. Hot in the sense, not that hot, but the patient cannot tolerate that hotness in his body. Even if you make the patient to sit in a cold climate, he might sweat. Why?